networks were the most phenomenal thing that could ever happen to us, was the opportunity of me being in five places at once, my knowledge being in 1,000 places at once. Unbelievable power. You take that to the wireless level, you take it to the miniaturized level that we have today with our phone systems. Each one of those steps has allowed the most important component, i.e. understanding, to become broadcast and become usable. Now, we've got to go one more step. And somebody you know, who I have only met a couple times, but I have great reverence for, Alan Kay.
Yes.
He tells a great story about him and his wife when they went to, I think it was Nepal. And she apparently likes languages. And so they were going around, and every time she'd point at something, and the translator would tell her what that was in Nepalese, and she would then try to learn. Well, one of them was a leaf. She pointed to this beautiful leaf, and he told her the word, and then about 15 minutes later, they were walking, and she saw a leaf on the ground, and she picked it up, and being a smart aleck, she said, the word. And the guide said, no. And she was dumbfounded. She thought she'd mispronounced it. It turns out, no. When it's on the tree, it's a leaf. When it's on the ground, it's debris. That's a completely different picture. Now, take that one step further into something that's more technically oriented. How many metaphors in our Western view are absolutely mind-boggling and dumbfound a person with, say, a Chinese background? And the reason is, they don't have a corollary. Now, what's the most fundamental of those? We've spent the last 50 years using computers to do what with much of what we do? Alphabetizing. We've built directories. We use our alphabet as a guide to doing that. They don't have an alphabet. Their ideograms do not have any connectivity with one another. They're individual symbols. So how does a Chinese person organize information, or how do they approach? When I was working with the Japanese, and the guys at Park were working on a way to help the Japanese organize information through their document management systems. And they tried everything in the world. And finally, they discovered that the best filing system for the average Japanese worker was something that had two characteristics. You could have piles, and you could flip through them quickly. So they built a user interface where the person would touch the lower right corner of the screen, and all the things in your pile would go through very rapidly, and you could see what was on the corner, and you go, yeah, it's right there. Because you remembered spatially where it was at, because they had no other mechanism to organize it. So when I had one of my books translated to Chinese, and the lady that did it had to rewrite 25% of it. She said, you used analogies, you used metaphors, none of us would understand what we're doing. So those are impediments that computing could significantly help us with, by either pointing out that we're doing it or by giving us alternatives. And I see a time in the future where true globalization, which means not just the connectivity, but the co-working, I won't say the word collaboration because it already carries too many pieces of baggage, but co-working, companion level working, is something that the kids today are striving for. They would love to be able to do it. They're already at that point. We've given them the communication, we've given them the networks, we've given them the tools at a cost level that penetrates almost all economic levels. So the next question is, what will they begin to demand as this sort of fluidity, this sort of organic environment that will allow them to truly communicate? And so that's what I was struggling with, is the journey to get there can't start with that being the goal. The journey to get there is for us within our own context to begin to recognize how little we've done to take information. For example, here's a dumb idea. What if an organization were put together that was a gatherer and organizer of the knowledge related to what constitutes sustainable behavior? So this just relates to fuels, materials, water, all these other things. The rules are basically the same no matter what you're trying to do, because those commodities only have certain behaviors. So if I had an opportunity to build a cloud, a sustainability cloud, it would sit out there and would allow people to run through it information that it could understand about my intentions. So I don't care if it's an engineering design or the planning of a community. Then the tools that are in that cloud would pick out the things they understood how to address, develop a summary of that, and provide that back to the sender. Now, if we could do that for resilience, sustainability, some of the other things we talked about, now we've optimized the investment in doing it. We've centralized only in the sense of certainty of where to go to get it, not in the sense of physicality. But people know where to go to put these rules. And that's the thing we haven't yet done yet. We haven't really embraced the idea of taking these new constructs in computing and utilizing them in a way that says that they are truly open to all comers.
Mm-hmm. Okay? I love this word, the companions.
Yes.
So, in a way, the words in 1960, when Licklider said man-machine symbiosis, it's as if you've suddenly acquired a new friend or a mentor or a guide, and you're about to go do something, and or you'd like to do something, and the guide said, you know, if you turn left right here, you can find it around the corner, or don't drink that, or all those things that
right.
a lot of other people's knowledge could contribute in altering your behavior. And in sustainability, when you look, every time I'm with someone that knows a lot about the lighting systems or the water systems, they'll look and they'll say, you see this? And I look at it, it's like going to listen to an orchestra and you hear the music, but if you're with someone really knowledgeable about the music, they pick out 100 things you didn't know.
Okay.
About now you'll see the theme reversed. Who knew? You're with a guide. So a guide in just looking at the world would look at this building and say, you know, those lights are on all the time. Why is that? How silly. Look at this road. Look how much asphalt went in. There's no mechanism for anyone to get around in Scottsdale, Arizona, if you don't have a car. So the trips and the movement is costing everybody so much. Who thought when they built this place that they would be imposing for generations, for 100 years, these costs that just are inherent in the way they designed it? They didn't think about it at the time because they didn't have a companion that was saying, watch out when you design this, that you don't build into it something really inefficient or something really fragile.
And the key to John's notion about metaphor is that that's the tool that allows us to create something that an appliance would know a set of rules, and it could guide me with those regarding those rules. A companion knows my goals. It knows what I'm interested in and will proactively inform me when I've traipsed into an area that I didn't remember either was contrary to my primary goal or was something I needed to at least take into account. So a companion is proactive versus an appliance that is reactive.